Good morning. We say we greet you in the sovereign, the sacred, the supernatural name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We're so grateful to God to come before our New Bethel Church family along with our friends as well. Amen. At this time, we ask that you will invite others to join us at this time. So we give honor to our most illustrious pastor, Pastor J.P. Walker, First Lady Florida Walker, to my lovely wife, Lady Katina Walker. We bless God for our media ministry that has been providing us with this opportunity to come before you each Sunday and Wednesday. We thank God for our Ministry of Music, along with our music department this morning. Amen. We're just so grateful to God to come before you once again. We ask that you will remain with us after the message in the appeal because we will have the awarding of our Dr. R.B. Harris Scholarship right after the message. But we'll let you know more about that after the message. We want to continue to encourage our members to continue to follow the guidelines. Amen. We don't want to take COVID-19 lightly. I know that the government is loosening some of the restrictions and some of the stay-in order, but we want to make sure that we are still adhering to the guidelines, amen, because it's more prevalent in our community than anywhere else. So we just want to make sure that we're educating ourselves and that we're doing our part, amen. Let us pray. O gracious eternal God, we come with a heart of thanksgiving. Father God, we thank you for blessing us to see another day. Dear God, we realize that it was nothing we've done so good nor great, but it was simply because of your grace, because of your mercy, that you allowed our golden moments to roll on a few days longer. Dear God, we say thank you. Dear God, we pray that you continue to cover our church family with your mighty hand of protection. Father God, we pray that you will strengthen our immune system, build it up, dear God, that we'll be able to fight off various viruses that's out there. Dear God, we pray that you continue to bless and keep our pastor, First Lady. Dear God, just keep all of us. Heavenly Father, help us keep our minds stayed on you. Dear God, we ask right now that you will bless our graduates, whether it's high school or college, dear God, as they prepare to go to another phase in life. Dear God, we pray that you will move upon their hearts to let them know that they can't go anywhere without you. And dear God, help them to look to you, dear God, for the source of their strength. Dear God, we thank you and we praise you. In the mighty name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen. There is a word from the Lord on this morning. We ask that you will pray with us and pray for us, but we definitely need your prayers. We ask that you will look with us in the book of Deuteronomy. Book of Deuteronomy, the 31st chapter. The 31st chapter, we're going to look at verse 7 and verse 8. Deuteronomy, the 31st chapter, verse 7 and verse 8. And it reads, Moses called unto Joshua, said unto him in the sight of all Israel, Be strong and of a good courage, for thou must go with this people unto the land which the Lord hath sworn unto their fathers to give them. Thou shalt cause them to inherit it. And the Lord, he it is that doth go before thee. He will be with thee. He will not fail thee, neither forsake thee. Fear not, neither be dismayed. May God add a blessing to the readers, the hearers, and most of all, the doers of his holy and divine word. I'd like to use for a thought on this morning, going forward. Going forward. There's a phrase that says, easier said than done. And I think that phrase is best suited for the phrase going forward. Some would argue and say that That's simple. That's easy to do. Because all you have to do is put one foot in front of the other and you can go forward. Well, we're not just talking about in a physical sense, but metaphorically speaking, moving from one phase of life to another phase, from one level in life to another level. As we understand our graduates, they're moving to a different place in life now. And while some would already say that that's quite simple to do, well, in order to go forward, you have to leave from where you are. Some would say, duh, but you have to move from where you are when you're going forward. You have to move from the known to the unknown. When you're going forward, you have to move from the comfortable to the uncomfortable. And that's sometimes it's kind of hard to do. Moving forward sometimes because the unknown, I notice that the unknown is fearful. It's frightening. And we just be honest this morning, sometimes it can be quite terrifying. When you're moving into the uncomfortable, the unknown, sometimes your fear, if you're not careful, it will immobilize you. It can paralyze you, put you at a point where you feel like I can't go any further. And while this sermon is fashioned and tailored for our young people, I think I'm talking to someone else this morning because all of us at some point in time or another had to move forward. We had to move from where we were to get to where we were going. And I might be talking to someone this morning because you may say, well, Reverend, I'm at that point right now. I'm at a transition in my life because it's time for me to move forward, but I'm afraid of the unknown. Somebody is about to move from the single status to the married status. Somebody is thinking about moving from the childless status to the starting a family status. Others are thinking about a career change. And some are even thinking about going back to school, but you are afraid of the unknown. Well, to all my brothers and sisters, and even my young people this morning, I say to you, the Lord sent me by New Bethel this morning to encourage you to go forward. Yes, I know you have to leave from where you are to get to where you're going, but you have to be willing to move forward. Yes, because the God we serve, he's not a God of stagnation, but he is a God of progression. God, he never meant for us to stay where we were. I can hear him saying in Jeremiah 29 and 11, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope in a future. God doesn't want us to stay where we are. Even when he created Adam and Eve and put them in the garden, they were to start in the garden, but not to stay in the garden. Because I did hear him say around Genesis 1, 28 or 29, it says that be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. So God started them in the garden, but they were to expand beyond the garden. That's what brothers and sisters are. Even us as believers, we started out as sinners, but we had to move forward from sinners to a saint. And then you have to move from a saint to a mature saint. And then from a mature saint to where Jesus is, and that's paradise. Yes, God wants us to move forward, but I can see you. Some of you are nervous. Some of you are anxious, but God wants you to know that if you just go forward, he's going to be right there with you. As I look at our text this morning, lest I hold you too long. Moses here in this text, he's addressing, before he addresses Joshua, he addresses the children of Israel. Let them know that, I'm paraphrasing 1 through 6. And Moses held the children of Israel, he says to them, look, I'm an old man now. I'm 120 years old. Can no longer go in and out before you. As a matter of fact, I'm about to transition myself, about to move forward from this scene to another scene. God is not going to allow me to go over Jordan with you. But he's assigned that to Joshua. But he encouraged Israel, let them know that you all are to go forward. And in going forward, he said, don't worry about anything, because what you're going to face, just like God took care of what you've already gone through, he's going to take care of what's in front of you. He said, if there's a question, just look at what God has already done to the kings of the Amorites, Og and Sidon, how God took care of them. He's going to take care of all of the other enemies that are before you. So my brothers and sisters, tell them to go over there. Tell them to be strong, to have good courage, and don't fear. For the Lord is going to be with them, and he's not going to fail them. Then he looks to Joshua, called Joshua amongst the children of Israel. And now he looks at Joshua, and he began to encourage Joshua. Joshua, you remember Joshua. Joshua was the one that when they were fighting against the Amalekites, and Moses told Joshua, you go down in the valley of Rephidim, and you fight with the Amalekites. Myself, Hur, and Aaron, we're going to the top of the mountain. And Joshua, he was a brave soldier, went down there and fought with the Amalekites. And he defeated the Amalekites with the help of the Lord. But I noticed one thing, a few things that if we're going to move forward, there's a few things we need to consider. Yes, there are a few things we need to consider if we're going to move from where we are and get to where God is taking us to. First thing we need to consider is our conduct. I see Moses, the first thing he reminds him, he tells Joshua in so many words, be mindful of your conduct. What do you mean, Moses? Moses telling him, look, your conduct should be one of strong, one of good courage, one of not being afraid and not being dismayed. That is the conduct that Joshua was supposed to have. Tell him, first of all, he tells him to be strong. What does being strong really mean? Being strong means that you rally the strength that is within you. Well, then, if that's what being strong is, what does being courageous mean? Courageous means concentrating on that strength that is within you to work against the dangers and the difficulties that lie ahead of you. So he tells Joshua to be strong. Be courageous. And then he goes on to tell him at the end of verse 8, he tells him that fear not. It's kind of strange that he would tell Joshua, the one that fought against the Amalekites, to fear not. Well, my brothers and sisters, when you make that transition, although you were brave where you were, sometimes you can be afraid to move from where you are. While Joshua was there, the brave soldier that defeated the Amalekites, but now he's about to move to another level in life. He's moving from being a follower of Moses to being a leader of the children of Israel. It's easy to be comfortable, young people, when you're under mom and dad's wing. But it gets to be a little nervous, nerve-wracking when you have to try your own wings. It's easy when you're operating off of dependency. But it becomes a little more difficult when you have to move towards independence. But Moses, he let Joshua know that it's time for you to move from where you are. Go to where God is taking you. It's time to move from being a follower to being a leader. He tells Joshua, say, look, be strong. Be of good courage. Don't fear. Don't be afraid. And I hear God telling us the same thing in Psalms 27, where it says, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Whom shall I be afraid of? As long as you know you got God there with you, young people and everyone else, you don't have to fear, because God is there with you and he is your strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. As Nehemiah said, the joy of the Lord heals my strength. You ought to operate off your strength. And lastly, in that point, he says, and be not dismayed. This word dismay in the Hebrew simply means to don't be broken. Don't be crushed. Don't be torn down. Don't be discouraged. In other words, he's telling him, whatever you face, don't let it get the best of you. Young people, there are going to be some exams that you may not do the best on. Don't let it get the best of you. In other words, don't let it break you. Don't let it shatter you. Sometimes you may have to drop a class and pick up another class, but you may have to change your major after you've already gone to school two or three semesters. Don't let it break you. Know that God is still there with you. Not only do we need to consider our conduct, secondly, we need to consider our commission. Moses, let Joshua know that you are commissioned, you are authorized, you are commanded to do something. Say that you are to go with this people into the land that the Lord has promised them. That's your commission, that's your command, that's your authorization. And God has commanded us. He has commissioned all of us, even young people, and your commission is not based upon condition. Let me say that one more time. Your commission is not based upon condition. He did not say that we are a commission. Well, first of all, we have the Great Commission. And the Great Commission simply means that as we go, we are to make disciples of those that we come in contact with. He did not say that you had to be a certain age. He did not say that you had to be a certain gender. But the only thing is, you have to be a believer. And if you're a believer, we're to tell men, women, boys, and girls about Jesus. Even as you go to college, young people, you're going to come in contact with some people that haven't met Jesus. They haven't met the tear wiper. They haven't met the midnight rider. They haven't met the one that will rock them when they get weary. They don't know anything about them. And it becomes your divine duty to tell them about Jesus. Tell them about one who came, bled, died for their sins. But God raised them up on the third day morning. Yes, we are to tell them, even as young people, you are to be a witness for the Lord. Songwriter said, who will be a witness for the Lord? See, Moses is telling Joshua, you've been commissioned. But thirdly and finally, we have to be considerate of our companion. And the companion, it makes the first two easier. Yeah, when you know who the companion is with you on your journey. Then the companion is, in verse 8 it says, in the Lord. That is our companion. Then the Lord, he's going to be there going before you. And then he's going to be with you. Yes, the companion is Jesus Christ himself. Yes, when you know you got Jesus with you, it's easy to be strong. It's easy to have courage when you know you got Jesus there with you. It's easy not to fear, and it's easy not to be dismayed when you know Jesus is walking right there beside you. It's easy to carry out the commission that you've been given when you know that Jesus is accompanying you on your journey. So yes, my brothers and sisters, we need to realize that Jesus, he is our companion. He tells Joshua that he's going to go before you. And then he's going to go with you. And then, Brother Taylor, I began to be somewhat perplexed about that statement. Because Moses, first of all, you told me that he's going to go before me. But now you're saying that he's going with me. And I had to ask Moses a question on last night. Then the question I asked Moses, I say, which one is it, Moses? Is he going to go before me or is he going with me? And the response Moses gave me was, yes. Yes, he's going before you and he's going with you. He said, Walter, you got to remember that he's an omnipresent God. That means that there's not a where, but there is a where. That Jesus is not there. So young people, I want you to know that Jesus is with you this morning. But he's already left for Hines Community College. Jesus is with you this morning, but he's already gone to Holmes Community College. He's already gone to Jackson State, Alcorn and Valley. He's already gone to Mississippi State and Ole Miss. He's already gone to Howard and Spelman. But I want you to know that he's going to go with you. That ought to bring you some comfort. I'm through with young people and older people alike. But I think I ought to tell you that you can go forward now. Now, I know there's going to be some mountains in your way, but you can go ahead and go forward. I know there's some valley in your way, but you can still go forward because you got somebody with you by the name of Jesus, and he know a thing or two about going forward. What you're talking about, Walker? Well, he was with his daddy in heaven and in paradise. But he looked down. He's all right. I know he's all right. He looked down and saw man in his sin. And you know what Jesus did. He went forward. He left his home in glory. Got on the nature train. Rode it through 42 generations. Got off in Bethlehem of Judea. You know what he did. He kept going forward. He healed the sick. He opened the blind eyes. Unstopped the deaf ears. He's all right. I know he's all right. But he kept on going forward. He's all right. I know he's all right. Because one Friday on a hill called Calvary, they put a rugged cross on his shoulder. They marched him up Calvary Hill. You know what he did. He humbled and died. But that's not how the story ends. They laid him in a body tomb. He stayed right there. But right early, if you was here this morning, I would ask you to shout early. Early Sunday morning, he got up from the grave with all power. Do you know he has power? He's all right. I know he's all right. Jesus will go forward with you. As a matter of fact, he's gone home with his daddy in glory. But the scripture teaches us that one day he's coming again. I heard him say that. I go away to prepare a place for you. If I go away and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself. That where I am, there ye may be also. He's coming again. I don't know about you, but I'm ready. Whenever he comes, I'm ready to go forward with him to a place where the walls are made of jasper. The streets are made with gold. Gates are made of pearl. But most importantly, Jesus is in that place. And I can sit by the river that flows through the city. And I can tell him all about my troubles. It may be that you're stuck in your sins this morning. And you want to move forward. You want to trust Jesus. You want to accept him. But Satan is tugging on you. I advise you this morning, tell the Lord that I'm willing to trust you. I repent of my sins. I realize that I'm a sinner. I'm in need of a Savior. And because I'm in need of a Savior, I realize that Jesus, he is that Savior. He's the one that came and died in my place. That all I have to do now is accept him as my personal Savior. If I do that, then I can be saved. The scripture tells us, Romans 10 and 13, for whosoever call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You can call him this morning, and you can be saved this morning. If you have called him and you feel that God has saved you, I encourage you, call a local pastor let him know that you've accepted Christ. And I can assure you that as soon as churches open back up, that they will take you in and that you will be baptized. Now, one would say, well, what if I die before churches open back up? Baptism does not save us. We are baptized because we are saved. I want you to know that you will go to heaven. But baptism, the only thing baptism does is an outward expression to the world that I have accepted Christ. If you have done that, call your local pastor and tell him that. And I can assure you that they will take you in. God bless you and God keep you. As I said earlier, I ask that you guys will remain with us for a few minutes. Our youth department is going to come now, and they're going to give the names of those that award the scholarship to the winner. Amen. So we ask that you will remain with us just for a few minutes. God bless you and God keep you.
Good morning. We want to congratulate all of our graduates of New Bethel. And we just want to say that we're so proud of you and we love you. Before I present our scholarship recipients, I would like to share with you how the recipients are chosen and scored. They receive points for a one-page essay where they discuss Psalms 150, verses 1 through 6, and how you praise God and experience God's presence in worship today. The essays are independently judged. They also receive points for their participation in third Sunday worship and other youth functions here at New Bethel. All About Me is a form that each graduate complete and submit with their essay. Scores are tallied, and the individual with the highest score is placed first. The recipient of the third place $250 scholarship and a fall and spring care package is a graduate of Wingfield High School and plans to attend Jackson State University in the fall. She plans to major in education. Congratulations, Cameron Jones. The recipient of the second place $500 scholarship and fall and spring care package is a graduate of Canton High School and plans to attend Hines Community College in the fall. He plans to major in music education. Congratulations, Desmond Wright Jr.
Scholarship and is planning to go to Holmes Community College in the fall and major in elementary education. And we want to congratulate Ms. Samaya Fowler. And also, we had two continuing educational scholarships that were awarded to students who were continuing their education, receiving a bachelor's or master's degree. The recipient of the $500 continuing education scholarship is Kennedy Walker, and she is pursuing a bachelor's degree at Mississippi State in mass communication with a focus and emphasis on broadcasting. And we just want to say congratulations to all of our graduates.
Listen, gather, I found something for you. If you listen well, I'm here to tell you you got nothing. Oh, a simple song, simple melody, yeah, to remind you that you can be the greatest ever, defeated never. Oh, even though sometimes you may lose so much.